so much for being here. The rain stopped just for this moment. It is my great pleasure to introduce artist David Ernster today. We've had a lot of fun working in these spaces, placing his work. He's been working incredibly hard, and we're really excited to hear what he has to say. David has a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Metal from the University of Iowa. He has a Master's in Fine Arts in Metal from the...
Ceramics.
First one's metal, sorry.
There you go. He's already teaching me. from West Virginia University. He taught for many years at Colby Sawyer College and recently taught a master class at the Currier Museum of Art. He's got a great workshop coming up here at AVA. That's the second weekend in June. It'll be 3 days. And there's flyers all around if you want to learn more about what David does and how. And David currently lives in Newbury, New Hampshire with his equally creative and talented partner, Misha Bergeron. And without any further ado, David Ernster.
What I'd like to talk about, I'm going to kind of go through a little bit of a sort of biography of my work and kind of how I got here, but what I really wanted to try and connect this back to is about how we think about objects and how we value objects and how we develop those connections to these things. To do that, I'm going to kind of go way back into some childhood occurrences and try to like keep connecting it back to this idea of objects and how we value these things. Like I was saying, I have taught for quite a while in many different places, but Colby Sawyer is like the longest stint there. And I taught a lot of classes there in art appreciation. And so I always open up these classes with, you know, what is the meaning of art, right? What's the value of art? You know, these kind of big questions that we all keep asking ourselves, right? Doing this for 40 years now, I'm still asking those questions to myself like all the time. You always get these kind of pat answers, well, art means something different to everybody, right? We all have different ways of looking at it, we all have different ways of appreciating it. You can't really, there's no definition of it, right? These are the answers that you're going to get all the time. You know, while I do think that that's valid, those are valid statements, but I think there's something deeper, that we can talk about that doesn't leave us out of the loop, right? So we actually can talk about that. We actually can have a discussion about these things. This idea of objects and how we value them. I think these kind of ideas get instilled in us at a really young age. And it takes us our entire lifetime to kind of work out what it is that these things are, and what they really mean to us. Just trying to come to some understanding of them. As a kid, I remember my grandfather built his own house. That was something to me that was incredible, right? As a little kid, I was standing inside these spaces and thinking, wow, built this whole place. And, I'd sit in the closets and look at all the jewelry, and I'd go to the basement and look at everything. It was just fascinating, really, really fascinating to me. This is an object, right? It's an environment, it's a large sculpture that he created. That sort of got me into this mode that I can build anything, I can do anything. It wasn't until he was lying in the hospital dying that we said, what the hell are you doing, David? You can't build a house by yourself. I, of course, decided to build a house by myself. I'm working on it for the past 25 years. Another 10 or 20, I might be done. He, of course, tells me that I didn't do this alone. I had my whole family and everybody But this idea of being able to like kind of build, make anything out of whatever's in front of you was something that I always found really intriguing, you know, really interesting. I got really interested in metal, and again, this may have had a lot to do with my experiences and the things that my grandfather showed me. He one time showed me, let me back up here. So I grew up in Iowa, on the Mississippi River. This is my hometown. This week, actually, it's kind of underwater right now. And we grew up on boats our whole life. You know, I spent on this river, on the banks of this river, you know, learned the water skiing when I was 8, 7 or 8. So we really spent our lives on this water and looking at this water. It really, to me, was, I don't know how to describe it. It was kind of godlike in a way. You know, it had everything, just always moving, always changing. It was just crazy mystery. The power of it, you know, it was just something that you couldn't stand against, right? But it was such an incredible, eye-opening experience, you know, to live with this thing. That slide there. So I would be digging through all this stuff and finding these things all the time. This is the Midwest, right? This used to be an ocean floor. So all of these crazy things, this to me was kind of a window into another universe, right? There's some subterranean world that I don't know about that we're standing on top of. You know, as a kid, you come up with all these crazy scenarios, right? What this is and where this came from. But this kind of mystery, you know, again, finding this after these floods, you know, these floods would strip the topsoil off and you'd find all this stuff, and then we'd go back and sluice and we'd find all kinds of stuff that we were left for. Right? We'd take a bunch of stuff away and leave a bunch of stuff. And so every year these floods, even though they're really destructive, I found incredibly fascinating, right? And I love getting out there right after these floods and taking a look around. Some of these are going to be a little bizarre. So my grandfather again, right? Getting back to that, and I, so along these rivers, on these railroad tracks, you know, we used to go down the railroad tracks, and we would put pennies on the tracks, and a train would come by and run them all over, and they would come out stretched out to be about 3 inches long, you know. And so right there, you know, I'm like, wow, that was a hard, solid object, and now it's something different, you know, now it's like this other thing. Really, really fascinating to me. Next one here. So the other thing he showed me was how to make a ring out of cork, but with a spoon. Turning in about a week. it all spreads out like this. So this hard object again, like totally transforms into something else, right? It's like a plastic material. During all this time, I'm also messing around with clay and stuff that I'm finding on the banks, but metal was something that, you know, I built a little bucking machine in the basement, and I had all these tools, you know, that I used, and I would make objects, you know, out of metal. Jewelry in particular, I thought was really, really fascinating. And not only because of the intrinsic value of the materials or anything, but more this idea of what it means to people, right? Everybody, many of you are wearing jewelry probably that's really dear to you, right? You'd be devastated if it was gone. You'd search the house, ransack the place. It's really not that valuable of a piece, probably, but you know, it means a lot. There's real value there to you as a person. So this idea of value, you know, of objects and how the kind of importance that we place on objects, you know, is something that I think from a really early age, I found really interesting. You know, I'm trying to remember how old I was when King Tut's tomb, you know, there was all this stuff that they'd sent to the afterlife with him, you know. And very, very profound kind of stuff. It's all metal objects and clay objects. So these ideas, you know, of value, from a really early age are kind of coming in. And these are kind of personal objects, right? your personal things that you don't use, that you have some investment in your psyche has. The work here in this show, I'm going to kind of phase in and out of things. This is kind of new talk, so it might be a little wrong. The objects, you know, that are here are just like a ring, like these rings I'm talking about, these objects that people wear and keep close to them, that are kind of these personal icons that are sort of symbols of your inner life, right? It's really what they are. So that's kind of what these are, right? These are kind of symbols of what's important to me inside my mind, you know. And you notice some of them are functional pots or objects. Some of them are sculptures. They're just forms. But there's a lot of pots, right? Pots, to me, again, are these, the idea of function is something that I go back and forth with because I really love sculpture. I love pure sculpture. I love painting. I love drawing. And I kind of want to do it all, and I try. But pots somehow have a special place because they are a real, because of what they mean to us, really, as a species, right? As a culture. They really have supported us in ways that have made it possible for us to be here today, right? We wouldn't be sitting here if we didn't have a way to stop chasing rabbits and sticks, right? And picking seeds and berries and nuts. We need a place to store things, we need a farm. So to me, pots, you know, vessels in particular, have this really deep intrinsic cultural value. And that's something that I'm really invested in as well. You know, in the same way that I feel, you know, jewelry has plays these roles for us in our lives. There was a, make this into a history lesson, but around the turn of the century, the Industrial Revolution, there was, you know, people feared that we would lose these traditions. And so William Morris in England, and Soichi Yanagi, Soji Hamada, Bernard Leach, they kind of felt like it was worth preserving these things, right? Because they felt like we would lose all this heritage. So the value in, for me, in like a cup, right? In like a cup that I drink water, it's more than a cup. That represents, you know, the beginning of time for me, of human time. So I feel really strongly about that kind of value in the work as well. I started making a lot of jewelry. I was making all this stuff at one time. But the thing with clay was, even though we had great, you know, ways to make great art classes when I was in school, and they did fire the pots that I made like as early as the great, we had to throw in the meal. But metal was something that I could do, right? I could do at home, I could do in my basement. It was something I could cut stones and polish and do all this stuff. So it was something that was a little more accessible to me as a kid. The other interesting thing about metal, sitting at the breakfast table reading my Captain Crunch box, and there's a whole scenario on the back, diagram about what I do. Steam casting, right? So that's pretty cool. So my father and mother were both very open and very creative people themselves. They say, okay, let's do it, right? So I start carving these little things out of wax, and we get plaster of Paris, and we burn this thing out in the oven, right? And melting lead on the stovetop, you know, in this little pan and casting these things. Today there would be sued for this, you know. But you know, this started, the idea of this changing states again, right? So this metal just becomes fluid like water, you know, and you can turn it into something solid, and there it is, it's back. I flip it back and forth. And clay, again, to me is very similar to that, right? It's a fluid, beautiful plastic material that you can, that turns into something completely different as you expose it to a certain kind of process. So I spent years building a little alcohol for some basin and pouring a little lead against walls of all kinds, you know, for the next couple of years. But I started, you know, getting a little more serious and making things that were a little more refined. This is a ring that I did in college. Got these opals, opal black jade, gold here. So, the river again. The area that you just saw that was underwater there, I used to hang out there a lot, and they were doing some big construction projects, and I went down there one day, and there were these scoops of clay, you know, about the size of the screen, maybe bigger, of this like jet black clay that they had dug out from a sewer project. So I, of course, my buddies helped me, you know, and we like cut these pieces and chunks of some clay, and so I had about 5 tons of it in the dad's garage for quite a while. I wasn't really happy about it. But I started using this clay, you know, and the funny thing is, right before I found this, I had this funky dream, you know, about black porcelain, you know, and all these black clay ships. So I started firing this up in a wood kiln as well. This was back in 1984, I think, at the University of Iowa. Before I was really huge in this country. Right now there's a lot of really great work going on with this kind of a kiln. But this clay that I dug out, that I found, you know, when I mixed with some other materials and fire, there's no glaze or anything on this. This is all flame patterns and things that are happening, you know, just from the atmosphere inside the kiln. You know, at this point in time, I didn't really have a huge grasp of the chemistry of what was going on inside this clay and what was happening, but I somehow really loved this idea of this local material and this whole thing. I mean, I'd make clay from something I dug up, we built this kiln, we, you know, we cut wood, we did the entire process pretty much from scratch, you know. So it was kind of a fun, I mean, it was really fun, it was more than fun. Got me obsessed in a way, you know, with doing it. Get that next one. So one of the interesting things about clay, also, that I find is that, you know, the temperature inside the kiln is really, you know, it's about this, you know, it's about 2,300 degrees. It's about the same temperature that's this molten rock is coming up from the magnets in the earth. Clay is, you take this stuff and you just age a few hundred thousand years and you get clay and you make something out of it and you just stick it right back in a volcano and you make it back into a rock again. There's this kind of circle, you know, that I find really kind of gratifying, you know, about clay as well. The next one. And it's a lot more complicated than you might think, right? And you think, well, you get it hot, it turns hard. There's a whole crazy series of crystalline structure changes that happen within the molecules of clay, and it won't just always happen the same way. It depends on the cycles, right? It depends on the heat, how hot it gets. It depends on these heating and cooling cycles on the way up. It depends on the heating and cooling cycles on the way down. It depends on how how hot the kiln gets and how slow it cools. So the size and shape of these kilns, as well as the way you fire them, has a huge effect on what comes out of them. Now, this is an old tea bowl from a rice bowl. There's a rice bowl in China, 12th century, I think, 12th, 13th century, 1270, somewhere in that range. This is what they call the oil spot glaze. I think this, I don't know if it's this particular bowl, but there are some of these bowls are really highly revered for the tea ceremony. The Japanese and the Chinese both really, really value these. And of course, it's created a whole lot of study in how can we replicate this, you know, because, you know, these bowls, this one in particular, I think you couldn't, they don't even let it out of the bowl. You can't even look at it. So you couldn't buy it from any amount of money. So they started studying these, and of course, you know, with technology now, we have electron microscopes, and they discover that inside of these funky oil spots, they find these minerals are formed of magnetite, hematite. It's an epsilon phase hematite. This stuff has this, like, it'll hold a magnetic signature, but when you expose it to a certain energy, it'll, like, keep that, right? So it's a lot like silicon chips in these computers. Actually, it's just as good or even better, but iron is so much easier to get, so it's cheaper than all these rare earths that we're digging out of it. So they, when they discovered this, they thought, oh, this is awesome, we're going to change the world with it. Turns out they can't seem to figure out how to make it, right? They can, in the laboratory, they can make these tiny little crappy crystals, but in the Song Dynasty, they make these beautiful, giant, gorgeous, perfect crystals of this hematite. So part of what you know, this idea about this legacy of the ceramic material, you know, kind of supporting us as a culture, it still is, and we still, even as simple as a little bowl like this looks with a glaze that we dug up some earth and some powdered seashells and some wood ash, you know, came out with this, we still don't get it, right? We still don't really understand how this happens, and we can't seem to reproduce it. So there's a lot there that's still valuable to us. It still has the ability to take us into the future here. So this is that's a electron microscope view of one of the crystals that's inside of that. Okay, so yeah, so we don't have to label this one, but that was just somewhat like a typical phases of the kaolinite clay as it's being fired. It goes through all of these crazy crystal machines. So, you know, this clay is here, for example, not unlike that last one that we looked at, has nothing to do with the heating and cooling cycles. If you just fire this thing up and shut it off, you can just see your red running blade without any of this stuff happening. So they're causing this to happen by delaying the cooling cycle at certain points in time. We have the chemistry of the glaze worked out so that it has materials in there to allow these crystals to form. So there's a lot of other interesting things about clay that I also think are really fascinating. This idea of iron is probably, you know, the most pervasive thing in clay, right? The kind of colors that you get, all the greens, you get iron reds, greens, blues, and it's probably the main, what many would call impurity, but it's not really impurity, it's part of the clay. But iron, when it gets heated to a certain, back up. The magnetic signature of the earth, this idea of radiocarbon dating, depends on our knowledge of what the magnetosphere of the earth was like at a certain time. When you heat iron over 1,000 degrees, it freezes that magnetic signature. So all these clay objects, because they last so long, and because they might have markings on them that might give us really specific ideas about when they were made. This was Sumeria, I think, the date. But when they discovered this, and they realized that, you know, the iron and this clay helped us, or had told us about the magnetic signature of the earth at the time it was fired. So that really improved their ability to, like, permanently, like a lot of things, right? So it's certainly getting slowed down, you know, because of these clay objects. So this idea of, like, building everything yourself, you know, from the time, like, you know, this thing with my grandfather, making rings out of quarters and building his whole house. So I'd go to the University of Iowa, and I live a bit reluctantly. My parents had forced me to go. I was like, screw it, I'm done with that, I'm not doing it anymore. They said, just go, right? And so I did. And of course, you know, 2 months later, running like a silly fool across campus, jumping for joy because I can't believe how awesome it is. But we in the art department, so I said, I'm going to at least, you know, take some art, do art, right? Take art classes. So this was a summer workshop, actually. That's Chuck right there, it's with Pines. And so we built this kiln, this wood kiln. It was a week-long workshop, and we were sitting out and we started firing. Next one here goes. at the same time, I'm still making metal, right? I mean, the same time, I'm still doing all this metal work. So my degree, what I'm actually studying here, is metalsmithing, jewelry. And I was working for my professor, who's a Korean woman, Chung Yi Chu, and she was making these. We had this big electroforming tank. We did hand raising and a lot of casting and a lot of everything else. So she actually hired me to be a production assistant, so I was making all of her work as well. So this is one of my pieces that is electroformed copper. At the same time I'm doing this, I'm also, in fact, it might be the next slide, let's see, another piece. So I'm also pouring a lot of iron and bronze, doing all this casting. So, I'm like, my grandfather used to say, like a big ship, he said, it's an island expression. You're element, So I just loved it, all of it, and we poured iron like every single week, I think for 2.5 years, bronze every other week. It was kind of a program that you would really, really learn, about it. So again, this whole idea of the metal, melting the metal, it's a solid. We were breaking up the radiators and bathtubs, so this idea of just building anything out of everything is still pretty pervasive. So we can go on here. So you start to see these things come back, right? These same things come back from the fossils that you take out as a kid. These kind of shells, but they're vessels, really, they're kind of the interior space. I did a lot of, these are carved negative molds, and if you can see inside this, there's all kinds of stuff happening on the inside. So again, like the river, they're a vessel, it's kind of a mysterious object, the space inside is something rarefied, right? It's like there could be anything in there, Pandora's box, this is containing energy or, keeping something in or keeping something out. This barrier, it creates, sets up a space that I think is, has a lot of meaning to me. We think of ourselves as vessels. We talk about our minds as vessels. There's a lot of metaphor that we can bring to the table with this kind of discussion. So building anything out of everything, right? Bunch of bricks left over, and I said, "Hey, Chuck, I want to build a kiln." He said, "Whatever." So he was a grouchy. He's a grouchy guy. So just do whatever. Get away from me. So I through these books, and I was just talking about atmosphere, about how different kinds of fire processes affect the clay and affect the chemistry of it. And these we call them Nagoriganma kilns. They're a climbing kiln. And it might be something you hear familiar with that. It's like if you see pictures of them, they climb up the hill, there's like a little series of these arches that climb up the hill. In those kilns, they would have one of them that has kind of an offset arch to create some turbulence, cause a little bit of reduction so that the fire, a particular kind of glaze, circulates like less oxygen, circulates like more oxygen. Potters left in the glazes from here. So this is one of these offset arches here. So I take one section of that kiln and just build it and see what I can see what would happen. So this is what we call a production machine chamber. And so this is one of the pieces that came out of it. There's no glaze or anything applied to this. This is all falling off. That offset arch also created set up a situation where that ash is a little heavier than the flame and starts to fall out like that. So this is all white porcelain clay body. This is all wood ash that's falling out in the pots. those T-bulls that we were looking at earlier, they kind of had the opposite idea of what they thought. They wanted T-bulls, you know, they fired all those inside of these little boxes, so that they were actually, you know, perfect, nice, clean pots. Mm-hmm. Today we all went thirsty. Sure. When I went to grad school, West Virginia, in the woods that I like to be, and ran across this thing. So this is an old pig iron furnace, Henry Clay iron furnace. Again, they just took the rock that was there and built this thing. The inside is lined with a pure silica sand that was also right there, you know. They're digging up iron. And the reason this is here is because there's a bunch of iron ore hanging out here too. So this was a big iron furnace during the Civil War, and they were using this to create iron ingots that they would then send to foundries to cast cannons and all kinds of stuff. But anyway, this was like a really kind of great thing to find, you know, for a guy like me, you know, out there. It was much like the iron thing that we were just looking at. So they just had iron ore, charcoal, limestone, and just keep doing this. And it was just on Easter Island, they found the same structures that were just like a giant chimney. And it would get up to about 3,000 degrees in the middle, and air would come pouring on the bottom. Pretty fun stuff. It's kind of, it's a type of kiln. So I'm building more kilns, of course. The steel industry was collapsing, which was bad for them and great for potters, because there's millions of bricks everywhere. Fingers would show up in big flatbed trailers full of pallets of bricks. So I was very happy to use them. So this is one of the kilns I built. This is cool here. It's a chamber wood kiln. These chambers have different effects, right? The configuration of these kilns, like I was talking about earlier, different kinds of effects on the wear. So a kiln like this is kind of like a shotgun, right? You're going to get this really directional type of flashings or effects on the clay. This one, you know, is a little softer, a little more gentle. You're going to get a different kind of look, you know, the pots back there, the glow on these on the front.
How big is it?
What's that?
How big is it?
How big is it? This one, the back chamber, this is probably 30 inches high on the inside. In the back here, this is probably 3 to 5 back here. That was fun. Can play with it. There's a picture of the fire in here. You can see it very well. We didn't have enough brick for the chimney, so I welded a bunch of old water meter liners together. A lot of good stories about that. So here's a couple of pots, you know, that came out of there. So you can see how, like, these shapes, you know, of the things that really imprinted on me, like the iron furnace, start showing up in this form of my work. Back chamber of that kiln, we would add salt to another chemical, another process, you know, and that's what this kind of orange peely look is on there. They figured that salt firing sort of got discovered by the Chinese who ran out of wood near the kiln and had to start floating logs across the ocean bays. They wanted to fire their kilns and they discovered lots of kilns by the Chinese. Those big kilns, right? They're a lot of work to fill. And I like big kilns a lot. but they have some drawbacks because it takes, you know, a month, 2 months, 6 months to make enough work to fill them up. Crew of people, 8 cords of wood, you know, I mean, it's a big undertaking. It's a lot of time, a lot of effort, and you got a lot of things in that basket, you know, and so you're. You know, for me, I really needed to do a little more quicker turnaround, right? Some testing to see what the hell was going to come out of these big kilns. Granted, you're not going to get the same thing happening in a little kiln like this as you would in the big ones, but you can get some idea where it's going, right? So we started with these little kilns, like Professor Bowen, Army Bowen kilns. Well, I'm just building, you know, and it would take me like a half an hour to put it together, and I would pause in there, you know, fire it up, and you know, by the end of the day, I'd have their cooling, right? And I'd start looking at them. So I built a lot of these things. I still use these a lot. You know, I think I have like two of them right now at home that I can play with. When I looked in the last kiln, so when I started looking at some old Japanese kilns, these raku potters used to do, raku is there's a bunch of pots back here that, you know, they say raku fire, right? Raku is actually a name of the family in Japan. The name was given to them by the emperor there, but the those little kilns, were made to make ware for the tea ceremony, you know, so they're usually part of the charcoal, but when I finally did see one, I never had seen one before, and I finally saw one not too long ago, and it looks an awful lot like that last little kiln that I just showed you, except they're part of the charcoal, almost identical, except there would be a little higher chimney here, and they would use a charcoal with a little bit more firebox, but they looked almost the same as this. Kind of similar idea in some ways. So keep building kilns, right? When I was in I moved up to this area. So I'm from Midwest, right, from Iowa, and I left to go to grad school in West Virginia, and then I came up here to make pots, production pottery, and I just make enough money to set up a studio and start working. I couldn't really wait, you know, for me to make enough money, so I started just scrounging old bricks from wherever I could get them, and I started putting together these quick little kilns, right? You know, one of the things that I think, to me recently is a little discouraging, is that you can't really, it's hard to get away with building anything these days, right? Especially if you're putting fire into it. Oh, you know, you know, you've got permits and fire checking everything out, right? And so you almost can't do it anymore. You know, but these kilns, I mean, you can, if you want to make pots, you can open these up, and you can, this kiln is actually a pretty decent size. And it fired really, really nice. And a lot of my friends would come use it because they didn't have kilns either. And this thing was up for probably 5 or 6 years while I was living where I was. And you can see this lovely flying buttress system here. It's with a fence post and old bricks and then strapped together with some steel cables, you know. But fire great, you know, really, really. I had a whole little village of these down here. You can see some more of them on this side. So as I started really looking at it, right, a lot of the shapes, the forms, the form follows function, right? They're very, very similar, right, in a lot of ways. The Japanese aesthetic is a little bit different because of their ideas about nature and decay and the cycles of life. So they're a little more sophisticated in that approach. But so I started finding saltware. And saltware is something that the blue and gray stuff you see, old crocks and jugs and stuff. That was brought over here by the Germans who got it through the trade. Europe got it through the trade with China, you know, back in the 11th, 12th century. So the Dutch and the Germans brought that to this country. They settled around the Pennsylvania area, right, area primarily, but all over the place, really. So I started firing salt. Salt has a lot of interesting effects on clay. I think there's any salt in there, fire salt. But it's also really hard in your kiln. It destroys your kiln and your kiln shed and everything else, right? The fumes from the salt are really corrosive. They collect on things, and then anything metal, you know, is gone. Anything with a lot of silica in it is going to start to melt after a while because the psyllium starts lowering its melting point and starts melting away. So salt kilns are usually built out of a really hard material that is not very energy efficient. And me being very poor, potter was looking at it, thinking about, was I going to spend $500 to fire this kiln every time? So I started trying to think about ways to build them. This is a castable material that I started building. I also, at this time, ran into a whole bunch of free fire clays. You use what you got, right? So fire clay and sawdust, and I was reading Mother Earth News, looking how they build grand earth homes, you know, where they build the structure. It's kind of like pouring concrete. You build a two-sided structure, and you start layering stuff in and tamping it. So I started building these things. So it's up, you know, put the arch on. This is what it looks like. So they really were great kilns. They worked really, really well. And one of the really great things about them also is that if you want to build another kiln, get rid of this kiln, you just crunch it up and remix it and make a new kiln out of it. So this one, you can see all these chunks, you know, spray two or three kilns in. You know, with clay you can build everything. I mean, you make your pots, you can make your house, you can make your kiln, you can make your glazes, everything on the same material, which is also very attractive to you. So another idea of value, right, that I kind of like with clay. Yeah, it was not an ideal location, my kilns. This gets really exciting, right, because there's a hill over here. Maybe a luge run. I had like five of these things in series. So this is where I'm at now, but this is quite a few years ago. I was wanting to build this kiln. And you know, I'm trying to visualize the scale and the shape, and I'm trying to work out the details of it. You know, so I figured, well, I'll just build it. Sheds over here that's freezing, so I thought, well, I'll play in the snow, so I'll make a kiln out of snow so I can look at it and see what the interior space looks like. And I haven't built this kiln, I'm dying to, though. If anybody wants a kiln, I'll build it on your property. Doesn't really fit on my property right now. But it was a really fun thing to do. Last salt kilns here. These are just a few old kiln pots here. So this is kind of fish imagery with something else working on. We don't really have any other sculptures in here right now. I kind of got tired of just drawing it on pots. I said just to start building fish instead. You know, there might be some pictures of fish at some point. We'll see. Thank you. So at this point in time, I didn't have a wood kiln, and so I ripped down a bunch of these other rubble kilns that I had, and me and my buddy just kind of pushed this thing together and made this little wood kiln. And this is actually built on the foundation of one of my old salt kilns. There's something here in this picture that's actually a little bigger than it looks like here. This kiln again, you know, it doesn't really take very much to fire pots, you know. As long as you get a box, you've got enough heat going into it, you know, it's going to work. Well, the configuration has to be somewhat reasonably efficient for the kind of combustion that you're looking for. But so this thing, you know, I would usually fire it in 15 to 20 hours, which the wood kiln's pretty quick, and it gets some pretty nice stuff out of this one. Keep going. Yeah, so these are some of the pots. You can see they're getting a little salt from the old foundation of that salt kiln that was in there. So really, I'm still mostly in functional vessels, you know. I still make a ton of functional vessels. I really love to make them. So, you know, I'm looking at, I really was interested in printmaking too when I was in school, and I did a lot of, I liked the metal, right? I liked to work with metal, so I did a lot of intaglio, etching, dry point kind of stuff like that. And I also was really interested in calligraphy and hieroglyphs and these kind of marks that had some kind of meaning, right? That we weren't really possibly not completely sure about what they meant, but it's kind of the energy of what you're seeing with them that was more important than really understanding literally what they mean. So I started translating these things into pots and trying to bring metal into the work as well. Not a lot of it here, but I made a lot of pieces that had big metal armatures that were holding, you know, the clay pieces up. This is actually this particular piece was sort of inspired by another Japanese kind of technique called kintsugi, which is a method of repairing work using lacquers, but then they use a layer of gold right at the very end, so it looks like you just poured molten metal into these cracks, right? This isn't done quite that way. This is done more with, I took a little diamond tool and I cut slots in it and I hammered it. Rolled out. This isn't gold. This is tin. And so then I hammer into these cracks. It's more like an engraving process. I do this with metal inlays, with guns, and a lot of other techniques. I think it's like when you hammer a soft metal and it spreads, it makes a physical connection to the knob to the base piece, right? So that's what I'm doing here. So I started playing with, you know, inlaying metal into these pots, and if I have too many slides, I can put them in this one. So yeah, this is a picture of traditional repair kintsugi. I actually just ordered a bunch of lacquers. I just started that. There's a few. This takes an incredibly long time. It takes the first part of the lacquer inlay, I think, takes over 3 weeks for it to cure enough, and then there's like three more steps. Right? So it's like this really long drawn-out process, but it's going pretty good sometimes. So this actually inspired me to kill a while back. Yeah. Brush stroke, kind of Hakame idea. Taimo is actually also looking at a lot of Native American architecture, these kind of these lodges that are built out of all these sticks, you know. And so this kind of these drawings, these images are mixing metaphors here.
So David, it's about 4:55. Do you want to have time for some questions, or do you want to jump?
Right.
It's up to you.
Yeah. Well, snap through a couple of them here. We'll see here. So again, no glaze. It's just from the kiln. Keep going. So I started looking at how they're building kilns other areas of the world. This is in Korea, where they build these kind of domes on these round pots of clay. So I'm thinking about this a little bit as well. We build a piece of it, but we sort of actually fire great for a while. It's we hold it there, so we now take that out. There's some pots that came out of that kiln. There's some metal pieces that I was making. So the idea of metal, right? You know, these kind of colors are coming from the exact same processes that caused these actual same colors in glazes. So there's, again, this big crossover between the two materials. Thank you.